So the last thing we talked about compact spaces, and the last thing we proved was a closed subset of a compact space is compact. That's easy. And then we proved that a compact subspace, subset of a Hausdorff space is closed. Okay? A compact in a Hausdorff space is closed. Otherwise, it's not true. Okay? Compact, if it's not Hausdorff, it's not true in general. So we proved some other theorems on facts. So here's a small lemma. So if f from x to y is continuous and x is compact, then f of x is compact. So this result, in words, the image of a compact set is compact, okay? That's what it says. The image of a compact set of a compact space or set is compact. The proof is very easy. So we have to prove that what f of x is compact. So let A be an open covering what should be compact? f of x and as usual in Y, okay? So I take open sets in the larger space. I don't let A be an open covering of f of x and y. Then the pre-image, then f minus 1 of A. So what is this? Obviously, this is f minus 1 of A, A in A, the pre-image, OK? F minus 1 of A is an open covering of X. But X is compact, so there's a finite subcovering. So X is compact implies then F of minus 1 of A has a finite subcovering. And then also A. We take the same. Okay. And then also A. And hence also A. So here you take a finite subcovering, and then do you take the corresponding here, okay? Theorem. The inverse, in general, the inverse map of a bijective continuous map is not continuous, okay? However, so if let f from x, y be bijective, and continuous, so we have a bijective continuous map. The inverse map in general is not continuous. But now we have x compact. If x is compact, And why is Hausdorff? Then F is a homeomorphism. So compact Hausdorff spaces, the situation is better. So the proof, what do we have to prove? We have to prove that, yeah, we have to prove that the inverse map F minus 1 from y to x is continuous. So that means that pre-images of open sets are open, okay? So pre-image under F minus 1, F minus 1 minus 1, that's F. So this is equivalent to the fact that F is an open map. That is, what means open means maps open sets to open sets, okay? Maps open sets. So this is a definition which maps open sets to open sets. Okay. However, in this situation, open map maps open to open. That's different from continuity, clearly, okay? Continuity is more important, but also this is important. Then there is a closed map. Closed means maps close to close, no? Continuous means pre-images of open sets are open, which is equivalent to the fact that pre-images of closed sets are closed. Open map means images of open sets are open. Closed map means images of closed sets are closed. That's not equivalent in general, okay? That's not equivalent. However, in this case, this is bijection, okay? And then it's equivalent, because since it's bijective, closed sets are complements of open. So map complements to complements, okay? So this means equivalent F is a closed map. Maps closed sets to closed sets. Since F is bijective, otherwise no. In general, it's not equivalent. Since F is bijective, so this is a, so we here we can prove that F is closed. Okay, this is equivalent. Inverse map is continuous. F is open. F is closed. So then it's easy. So let A be closed in, what is closed? F from x to y. Let A be closed in x. But what is the hypothesis? X is compact. What was that? A closed set in a compact set is compact, okay? So this implies X is, A is, what? Compact. So this is the fact, closed set in a compact space or set is compact. A is compact. This implies F of A is compact. So this is always what we use, okay? F of A is compact. What is this? The image of a compact set is compact. So F of A is compact. Where are we? In Y. So Y is Hausdorff. So this implies then that F of A is compact. F of A is closed. And this is what we proved, which I said now. A compact set in the Hausdorff space is closed, okay? A compact set in the Hausdorff space. Is closed. And that's it. So that means then we proved F is closed. So F is closed. The map F is closed, okay? And this is equivalent, as we said, that F minus 1 is continuous. So this is in fact equivalent. So F is homeomorphism, okay. So that's also easy. Now we have to prove other stuff, the main theorems about compact spaces. So the next theorem is the next theorem we prove is a product of finitely many compact spaces is compact. Product of finitely many compact spaces is compact. Let's prove this first, okay? So proof. And then you ask for infinity products, no? For arbitrary products, of course. What happens? And it's also true, but I comment on this later. First I prove this, okay? Here we don't see the difference between product and box topology, okay? Finite product is the same topology, okay? For infinite products, there is a difference in general between product topology and box topology. Okay, and also uniform. So there, the situation is more interesting in some sense for arbitrary products. So proof. A product of finitely many spaces. It suffices to prove for product of two, of course, finitely many. It suffices to prove the theorem. Theorem for a product x times y, yes, x times y of two compact spaces. X and y. Okay, so we have x times y only. And then we have a lemma, which is very useful lemma. And there will be some exercises also. So this is a tube lemma. Tube lemma. So what is a tube lemma? So consider x cross y And here we need only that y is compact, okay? Here is also x compact, but that we don't need now for the two problem. With y compact, consider this product. So we make a picture and write. So we have x cross y. So this is x and this is y, and y is compact. And now we consider a slice. So we have a point x0 here, some point x0, and this is called a slice. So this is x0 cross, what is it? X0 cross y, yes. Which is homeomorphic to y, by the way, okay? This is homeomorphic to y. What is the homeomorphism? Just forget this point, okay? This is a homeomorphism. As a subspace, there's no problem here. So let n be a neighborhood, so we have n. Oops. Whatever. So this is n. So I'm going to write n be a neighborhood. If n is a neighborhood, neighborhood. What is neighborhood? Open set containing, okay? Open set containing is a neighborhood of a slice, so this is, he calls slice, x0 cross y, a slice, x0 cross y, x0 in x. If n is a neighborhood of a slice, x0 cross y in x cross y, obviously, okay, then n contains, so then there's a neighborhood W of x0, so here's a neighborhood W. There exists a neighborhood W of x0 such that, well, this is not good. So here's W. Okay, such that the product W cross Y is contained in N, such that if N is a neighborhood of a slice, then there is a neighborhood W of X 0 in x such that that's a tube, that's what we call tube, such that the tube, that's a product W times Y. That's why the name, the tube W cross Y, is contained in N in this neighborhood. Given a neighborhood, okay, of a slice, there's a tube. Such that the tube such that is contained, I write is contained in what is it? N. Okay. So as in the picture. That's a tube lemma. If you have a slice and a neighborhood of a slice, then we find this tube, which is contained in the neighborhood, okay? Which is a product. This is not true if y is not compact, no? It is not true if y is not compact. Clearly, it's not true if y is not compact. You find easy examples, no? I mean, you have, for example, well, I will not. You take R cross R, okay? And then you have a slice, which is the y-axis, okay? And then you take a neighborhood of the y-axis, which looks like this, okay? Something like this, which comes closer and closer, okay, if you go to infinity. Then you don't find a tube here, which is contained in this neighborhood, because it comes arbitrarily close to the y-axis, okay? So you need some compactness, otherwise it's not true. Okay, so this is a tube lemma. That's the tube lemma, and this is also the picture, okay? So proof. Proof of the tube lemma. So we cover x zero the slice x zero cross y, which is homeomorphic to y. This is homeomorphism, no? This is homeomorphic to y. So it's compact. That's the point, okay? By basic elements of the standard basis of x cross y, u cross v, where u open in x, u cross v. So this is open in x, and this is open in y. This is the product topology, no? U cross V, okay? By basic elements contained in N, sorry, contained in, we have N, N is given, okay? This is open, contained in this neighborhood N. N is open, so for each point, there's a basis element which contains the point and is contained in this open set, which is N. So we find many of these for each point we can choose one of these, for each, okay? But this is compact. So we get, what do we get? We get an open covering of the slice in x cross y, okay? So we get, it's contained in N, so we get, we cover the slice, so we have an open covering of x0 cross y in x cross y. But x0 cross y, homeomorphic to y, is compact. Y is compact. So finitely many suffice to cover, okay? So this implies that we need only finitely many. Finitely many u1 cross v1. So finitely many of these suffice. So but it's compact. This implies finitely many of these names, and let me give them names, u1 cross v1, un cross vn, suffice, of these neighborhoods, suffice to cover whatever they should cover, x0 cross y. So finitely, so we have only finitely many here, okay? So it looks like this. Okay, finitely many. And we may assume, obviously, that x0, which is our point here, is contained in this first here, okay? We can be, suffice, okay, we can assume that x0 is in all of these. So ui, I from a 1 to n. Why can we assume this? Otherwise, if x0 is not in one of these, okay, then we can forget this, no? Because it doesn't help to cover x0 cross y, okay? So just forget it, okay? So we can assume that x0 is in ui. Otherwise, it doesn't help to cover x0 cross y, okay? And then we have our neighborhood, okay? So let w be equal to so we have finitely many neighbors, ui, and we take the intersection of all these, okay? Then w equal u1 intersection un is a neighborhood, clearly, of x0. Such that, and this is good, this is our w, such that w times y is contained in n. Okay, that's a proof. Of course, we have to see this also, okay, but is that okay, or? So this is a proof of the tube lemma, okay? And we will give some exercises tomorrow which use this tube lemma or generalize the tube lemma, okay? Now we prove the theorem. So, proof of the theorem. So, what we have x cross y. We have, no, but both are compact. So x and y are compact now. X, y compact, both. We have to prove that the product is compact. So let A be an open covering of x cross y. And we have to find a subcovering. For each x and x, the slice x cross y, so it's now x before it was x0, fixed, now it's also variable, of course. The slice x cross y, which is homeomorphic to y, is compact. A is an open covering of everything, so it covers also this slice, obviously, okay? The slice is compact and hence, and therefore, covered by finitely many elements in A, okay? And therefore, and hence, covered by finitely many elements A1, AN, whatever. A1, AM. In A. A is an open covering of X plus Y, but also of the slice, small x cross y, so finitely many suffice to cover. And now we take n, let n, so nx, now I give index x, is equal to a1 union, then nx, a1 union a, which depends also on x, of course, everything depends on x. An is a neighborhood of the slice x cross y. That's obviously a neighborhood, okay? The tube lemma now, okay? The tube lemma implies that there exists a neighborhood, there is a neighborhood Wx, depends on x also, everything, okay, Wx of x such that Wx times y is contained in nx. That's exactly the tube lemma, okay? We have a slice, we have a neighborhood of a slice, and we find a tube which is contained in the neighborhood. There's a neighborhood Wx of x, okay? So that's just a tube lemma. But now we have also an open covering of x. That's the main point. Now, then, and this implies, now we take all Wx, x in x, is an open covering of x. But now also x is compact, okay? X is compact. So this implies that finitely many suffice to cover x, okay? Finitely many Wx1 Wx, so what was the name for, this was n here now, so I call it m now, okay? This depends anyway on x is n here, okay? So Wfm, finitely many Wx1 suffice to cover x. So what? So x cross y is x is wx1 union wxn m cross y, which is wx1 cross y union Wxm cross y, okay. That's the case. By construction, each of these is contained in the union of finitely many elements of A. That's when you see the proof, then by construction, each of these is contained in a union of finitely many elements of A, of our open covering. If you look at the proof, you see exactly this, okay? is contained. And this implies, of course, that x cross y is covered by finitely many. Okay. For each of these, we need finitely many. Only there are finitely many of these. So, and this implies that x cross y is covered by finitely many. Well, gets smaller and smaller. By finitely many elements of A. Ah, here it is still. One second, I made a mistake, no?
No, everything is okay.
Yeah? By notation. Nx is neighbored, there's a neighbor Wx of Wx times y is in Nx. And now we have Wx cross y1. This each of these is contained in Nx1. So this is in fact it's equal because we anyway have everything. So in this nx1 union nx nx1 union nxn, and now each nx is a finite union of these. Okay, that's the proof, okay? So this is true in general. So and this is a famous theorem. Tychonoff theorem. I don't know. An arbitrary product of compact spaces is compact. Okay. Obviously, if you write this in the product topology, okay, in the product topology, in general, not in the box topology, okay, not in the box. In general, not in the box topology. In general, we will see an example, not now. Okay, it's not true for the box topology. So this, I will not. We do not prove. It's too long. There are different proofs. I mean, what we want, what would be useful here would be. That we will do anyway. We will use sequences for compactness, okay? But in general, sequences are not sufficient for compactness, okay, to characterize. Every, that we will see later. Every, what means compact? Any sequence that is a convergent subsequence, okay? That is not the same. This is sequentially compactness, okay? So it's different. It's not as strong as compactness, okay? And so we cannot use sequences. And then, to prove Tychonoff, one can generalize sequences, okay? And this is called filter. And then something is compact if and only if every filter has a convergent subfilter, okay? Then one can use it. And then it's a very conceptual proof, okay? Also for Tychonoff. We come back to sequences later, not now. And also to some example. That's not true in the box topology, okay? We see some example, not now. Instead, we have to prove some more standard things about compact spaces. Next theorem. There's a proof in the book, by the way, of Tychonoff in a later chapter, okay? But this is sort of long and one has to concentrate. It's not so pleasant for my taste. So it's not in this chapter, in this, which is what, the third chapter, 2, 3. We're in chapter 3, no, yes. It's not in this chapter, the proof, because it's longer and if I prefer a proof, I prefer a proof using filter, okay? Which is more conceptual in some sense. One can try to generalize this proof, but that's not so easy. It's not so okay. Okay, instead of doing this, we prove another theorem. Which is the following. Let X be an ordered set which has the least upper bound property. Let X be an ordered set with the least upper bound property. So we don't need the other condition here, okay? It's not a linear continuum, but with the least upper bound property. Then, in the order topology, each closed interval is compact. In the order topology, which is the only topology which we see here, in the order topology, each closed interval now, closed interval, is compact. So this means real closed interval, real intervals are compact, okay? That's of course important. They're connected, they're compact, okay? Both are at the basis of real analysis, now these two facts. One is used in the intermediate value theorem, right? And the other is used in the maximum minimum value theorem, which we see immediately after, okay? So this is in the basis of real analysis. Closed intervals, closed real intervals, are compact and also connected. Okay. What? Well, interval. No, the other one are arrays. Not bound. Intervals are bounded. Interval is A, B. Maybe open, half open, closed, but bounded. Interval is bounded. Otherwise, it's called array. A infinity is not an interval, that's a ray, okay? And minus infinity, A, that's, we don't call an interval. So let A, so proof. So we have to prove that each closed interval is compact. So a closed interval A, B, let A be smaller than B, and we have an open covering, as usual, A be an open covering. Of the closed interval, A, B. In the closed interval now, okay? I want to remain in this interval, okay? By open sets, well, the subspace topology is generated by intervals, by intervals again, by open intervals and half-open intervals, okay? On one side or by the whole, of course, okay? So open covering of the closed interval AB. And we have to find, again, a finite subcovering. So this is maybe a remark which I have written here. So I added closed interval open covering in the subspace topology, which, however, is the same as the order topology. That's not always the case, no? In the subspace topology, which is this, which, however, is the same as the order topology on AB, okay? Which is the same as the order topology on in this interval, okay? That's not always the case. We have one example where this is not true, where the subspace and the order are different, okay? That's the ordered square. The ordered square, the subspace topology as R cross R ordered, and the subspace and the order topology are different, okay? They're completely different, very different, okay? The interesting example is the ordered square, which is the order topology. The subspace topology is a completely, there are too many open sets, okay? But here it's the same for this interval, as you see, one. The point is that in this ordered square, the ordered square is not an interval, okay? I mean, itself in itself it's an interval, but in R2 it's not an interval. They're missing all this stuff, okay? If you have only the ordered square, it's an interval in the order topology, okay? But in R2 it's not an interval, okay? Here it's different because this is an interval, okay? So there are no missing points. That's a big difference between, well, whatever. Okay, so what we have to prove. So let's see. So we define C. These are all points Y in AB such that AY is covered by finitely many elements of A. So we take all points Y here such that AY is covered by finitely many elements of or open covering, which is always called A. Obviously, with A in C, so this is not empty, no? There's A. The point A is covered by 1, okay? So it's AA. That's an interval, okay? 1 point. That's okay. So let C be the least upper bound. Let C, small c, be the least upper bound of capital C. Okay? Take the least upper bound. Least upper bound property, no? Every non-empty bounded is clear here because we are anywhere, everything is in the interval. Subset has the least upper bound. The smallest upper bound, no? Yeah. So call it C. It's similar to the proof for connectedness, okay? So the first thing, what we want to prove is that C is in C. Okay? So the least upper bound. So two steps. First step, we prove the claim is that C is in C. So first claim, C is in C. That means that AC is covered by finitely many. Now that means AC is covered by finitely many elements of A. That's the first claim. So we prove this first. So choose one element of our covering which contains C. Choose A in A. Such that with C in A. So I make again this this picture which we did for the. So this is how is it called? Our space, our set is X, no? X, okay. This is X. That looks like the reals, no? It's not the reals, but it's an ordered set, okay? And so we have our interval a, b. And now we have c in a. We have some c. This is the least upper bound. And we can assume, obviously, that c. So I can we can assume that this is bigger than A. Otherwise, it's trivial because if C is equal to A, it's covered by finitely many. No, that's trivial. We can assume. Clearly, we can assume that C is bigger than A. So C is bigger than A. Otherwise, it's trivial. Okay. AA is covered by finitely many, by one, right? Since AA, that would be the case C equal to A, okay? It's covered by, this is A, no? It's covered by one element, okay? Of A. So this is OK. So we have this situation again, OK? And now C is in A. C is in A. A is open, OK? C in A, A open. C is in A. A is open. So what? We have the order topology, right? That means we find something here. On this side, I don't know. It might be B, right? But I don't care about this side. Here we have larger. Here we may be equal. Anyway, it's open, so there exists a D, which is D. there is D smaller than C, such that what we see DC is contained in the interval DC. Is contained in this open set, which was called A. OK, right. So this part is contained in A. Okay. So now, I say that AD is covered by finitely many elements of A. So why is that? I mean, what was C? That's the least upper bound of all elements such that the interval is covered by finitely many. So there are arbitrarily close to C elements here, Okay, such that the interval from here to this element is covered by finitely many. Okay, it's the least upper bound. So then AD clearly is covered by finitely many. Okay, because there are points arbitrarily close to C, which are covered by such that the interval is covered by finitely many. Okay, there are elements arbitrarily close to C, such that the interval from A to this element is covered by finitely many. Then AD is covered by finitely many. Okay. So that's by the definition of C. It's covered by finitely many of A. And then, of course, AC is covered by finitely many. Many elements of A. Why? Well, just at A, one element, okay? We have this part is in A, okay? Just at A. This A. So then we are up to this point, no? And this means C is in C, no? Clearly. And this is C is in C. So this is the first step. It's the first claim. C is in C, okay? You look at the picture, okay, and you see it works. What did we use? We used only the least upper bound property. Yes. This one, no? A is open. Okay? This A is open contains C. We assume that C is bigger than A, okay? Otherwise, it's trivial. So this means open. What means open? There, well, you may say that D might be A. That's okay. This D might be equal to A, for example, okay? Maybe there are not, you say maybe there are not too many points here, right? But D, in any case, might be A, for example, okay? That's also okay. So it's not a problem. We don't use a linear continuum. We use only the least upper bound property, okay? We just use the definition of what is open, okay? A is open, contains a point. So there's some interval, okay, which contains this and is contained, okay? Yeah, some basis element. Of course, this D might be equal to A, okay? No problem. If there are no points here, no, then D is equal to A, maybe, okay? But that's not a problem. Okay. Second step. Second claim. First claim. Second claim. C is in C. And the second claim is C is equal to B. Then AB is covered. This proves the theorem. So this implies AB is covered by finitely many elements of A. So this is the theorem, okay? C equal to B, that's the thing. Okay, so suppose C is smaller than B. Suppose, by contradiction, that C is smaller than B. And now we have, again, our picture, always the same picture, four times, okay? So this is X, this is A, this is B. And now with C smaller than B, okay? So there's some C here, and we are sure that this is not, we suppose by contradiction that it's smaller than B, okay? C is smaller than B. I don't care about this side, okay? Here, maybe equal, or I don't care. I'm interested on this side now, okay? But we have the same notation as before. C in A, A open, okay? Let, so it's the same. Let, as before, I write the same. Let C be in A, in A. Okay. So what do we have, first of all, I lost my, what do you want to prove? I get lost. this is our picture now, of course. No? Now we do the same as we did before on the other side, okay? So A is open again, right? A is open. What does it mean? It means we find some D on the other side now, okay? So there is D bigger than C now, such that the interval from C to D, this interval, I don't care on the other side, okay, is contained in A, which is open. And we're looking for a contradiction now. But it's clear a contradiction now. Because now, AC is covered by finitely many, OK? AC is covered by finitely many elements. Finitely many, I abbreviate now. I'm always finitely many. Elements of A. Why? This is the first step, no? So first claim. So AC is okay. But then what about AD? Also by finitely many, no? This implies that also AD. Is covered by finitely many elements of A. Why? Way up to C, we are it's okay, finitely many, no? Just at A, maybe that's not sufficient, no? Just at A, then we come up to D, but maybe not D itself, okay? And maybe one, maybe A contains D, then that's it already, okay? And maybe one other element of A which contains D. Just at A, and maybe, possibly, one more element of A which contains D. Which contains D. This is if D is not in A, okay? If D is in A, if D is not in A. Okay. Then it's covered by finitely many elements of A. AD, okay? But D is bigger than C, right? And that's a contradiction. What was C? C was the least upper bound of all elements such that the interval is covered by finitely many, okay? So this is a contradiction. So definition of C, okay? Definition of C. So that's a proof. Very similar to the proof connected, okay? These pictures here, no? you look at one side and then you extend a little bit, and so on and so on. Okay. Corollary. So again, we didn't use the linear continuum. We used in this proof, we use only least upper bound, okay? Property, so corollary. Each closed interval, each closed interval it's closed real interval AB in the reals is compact. Closed real intervals are compact. That's important, of course, okay, for analysis. And that is what? Well, no. So this is a better approach, okay, with compactness. You don't use, we prove Heine-Borel now, okay, immediately, but we don't use it. So this is a nice example. And in general topology, we are always these strange examples, okay? So the ordered square is a strange example, but it's compact, okay? The ordered square. I ordered square. This is a closed interval, okay? This is 0 cross 0, 1 cross 1. Okay, it's compact. Why? This has the least upper bound property, no? For connect, it's a linear continuum. This is a both are linear continuum, this and this, okay? So they have, so it's compact. So this nice example from analysis, this French example from general topology, okay? The ordered square is compact. This is an interval. The space is the ordered square, okay? It's not an interval in R2 with the ordered topology, okay? That's a strange situation here, okay? We are considering only the ordered square, I cross I, okay? We are not looking at R cross R. In R cross R, it's not an interval, okay? Because they're missing all these points above and below the ordered square, okay? So that doesn't work here, okay? So here the subspace topology and the ordered topology are different topologies, okay? They're not the same topology. The ordered square as a subspace of R cross R, I cross I, as a subspace of R cross R with the ordered topology. That's one. And the other one is the ordered topology directly on I cross I. That's the ordered square, okay? These are very different topologies. Okay. So we give some explication of this. We give exercise tomorrow that the ordered square. We prove already. You should know that the ordered square is a linear continuum. Okay, it has the least upper bound property. You look at first coordinates, then at second coordinates. Okay, that we did. It's connected also, no? It's connected. And now it's first countable. That's no problem, okay? It's first countable. That's very easy. RL is first countable, very easy. Both are not metrizable, okay? RL was an exercise, which I will do at the end maybe today, okay? There was an exercise. And here's the same exercise now. This is not metrizable, okay? And it's not so trivial to prove it's not metrizable. So, but you can use compactness, okay? It's compact, and then we prove using compactness that it's not metrizable. It cannot be metrizable. Because a compact metric space, the reason is easy. the exercise is a compact metric space has a countable basis. But this ordered square does not have a countable basis. Okay? That's the idea. That will be the exercise. A compact metric space has no. Okay. First, I go on with the. So, Heine Borel, you take it as a definition almost of compactness. But that's not our so theorem. It's not our definition. So, this is Heine Borel. So what does it say? A subset R of Rn is compact. A subset R, a subset what? A subset A in Rn is compact. If and only if. If and only what? If and only if it's closed and bounded, okay? A is closed. And bounded, bounded, we have to be careful, no?
Which metric?
What?
Which metric?
Yeah, which metric? With the Euclidean metric, okay? With the Euclidean or the square metric? Or the square metric, yeah, square metric, right? With the Euclidean. Of course, each metric we may cut at one, okay? So each metric is bounded then, right? No, no. What?
Rn is finite dimensional. As a vector space, it's finite dimensional.
As a vector space, yeah,
yes.
That's and yeah, that's
so
linear.
Every metric, all the metrics defined on it are equivalent.
No, no, no. But what do you mean equivalent? What is a metric?
The
discrete metric, for example. What metric? Yeah, on Rn. On each set, you have the discrete metric, right? That generates a discrete topology, no? There are many metrics, there are many topologies. It's not so clear. So, in the end, bounded in the Euclidean, or all metrics on Rn generate the same topology, is not true. It's not true. The discrete metric generates a discrete.
No, no, no. I mean norm. No. All the norms are equivalent, but not all metrics.
The norm, yeah. In the Euclidean. One second, what do I have sense? A is closed and bounded in the Euclidean or the square metric? Yeah, you have scalar product, norm, and metric, okay? And it's not always clear. A metric does not come from a norm. A norm does not come in general from a scalar product. So there's this. proof of Heine Borel. No, it's a theorem. We never use this, okay? So proof. There are two directions. One is not very interesting. Which one? If it is compact, then it is closed. But that's not interesting, okay? So this should be the easy direction. So A now is compact, okay? We know already that A is compact. And then we have to prove it's closed and bounded. So we have an open covering. A is contained in the union ball. I forgot what was the Euclidean metric. D, distance maybe, okay? So this is a Euclidean metric. Zero n, n in n. Yeah. That's trivial, right? This is Rn. A compact. So this is an open covering, right? Open covering of A. This is an open covering of A. A is compact, means it's contained in finitely many of these. Then take the maximum, OK? So A is contained in BD, 0, n for some n in n. And this, of course, means that B, A is bounded, right? It's in some ball here. A is bounded. What else? Closed. Closed? A is compact. A compact. Yeah, right. So A is closed as a compact subspace, as compact subset of a Hausdorff space. Of the Hausdorff space. Rn. So that's what we need, bounded and closed. So this is easy, OK? What is interesting is the other direction, of course. Because here we have to prove it's compact. So A, now A is closed and bounded. This implies closed, bounded means A is contained in, bounded. In some ball here, okay? But now I take a square, a big square, okay? So I take bounded means also it's contained in, so I take minus nn. To the n in Rn, okay? This is bounded, okay? It's bounded. This is how it's called. It's a square, hypersquare, okay? This is a hypersquare. So we have, if you want the square metric here, here we have the, but it's. And now we use everything which we proved, OK? This is the non-trivial direction. So minus n, n in R is compact. That's what we proved. Real intervals, closed intervals are compact, okay? And this implies that minus n, n to the n is compact. What is this? Finite product of compact spaces is compact. A finite product of compact spaces. Is compact. What do you want to prove? A is compact. So A is contained in this, and this is compact. A closed. A closed in a compact is always compact, okay? This implies A is compact. So here we don't need Hausdorff stuff even, okay? This is trivial. A closed subset of a compact space is compact. I mean, the proof is trivial, no? If you have a closed subset of a compact space, if you have a if you have an open covering of a closed subset in the whole space, you just add the complement, which is also open, and then you have a finite cover of the whole space, and then you have finite subcover. So this is the proof is very. Yeah. So A is compact, and that's it, right? Yeah, that's what we should have proved. The last thing which I prove here is maximum minimum value theorem. And this is also trivial almost now. Here we don't use anything. So minimum maximum value theorem. It's analogous to the intermediate value, okay, which is also, we use only definition. So now we proved Heine-Borel. No, we never used Heine-Borel, okay, to prove that anything compact, okay? We never used it. This is a proof. So maximum and minimum value theorem. And now you see this is a trivial theorem. Minimum value theorem. Very important, but almost trivial in the sense that we use only a definition of compactness, nothing else. So what does it say? Let f from x, y be continuous. Let be continuous. Where y is ordered in the order topology. Where y, we have to compare elements, maximum, minimum, no order. Where y is ordered with the order topology. If X is compact, that we have to prove first to apply the theorem. We need that X is compact. Okay? And that might be the work. If X is compact, then there exists, then there are points CD in X, CD in X, such that f of X, for any point, it's f of C between f of C and f of D, for all X in X. Okay. So this means f assumes its maximum and minimum, no? That's in words. So this means that f assumes its maximum, well, maybe it's stupid, f assumes its maximum minimum. Maybe it's not useful to write this way. I mean, that seems to be trivial, it's maximum and minimum. Otherwise, it would not be a maximum minimum, but it would be a upper bar. Yeah, right. So.
Doesn't make sense. F has a maximum and a minimum.
Yeah, right. That's better. Okay. So proof. So X is compact, F is continuous. That means the image F of X is compact. The image of a compact set is compact. And this implies, so he calls A, maybe, F of X is compact. This implies that minus infinity A, A in A, is an open covering of A in Y. It's an open covering. Of A in Y. By open sets. These are open sets, no? In Y. Rays. Not interval. Ray. Open rays. Okay? These are open. And it's an open cover. Why is this? Sorry. Suppose that, I forgot to write something, okay? Suppose that F has no maximum. By contradiction, okay? That I forgot. Suppose that F has not a maximum. Then this is an open covering of A. Why? A is F of X, no? This is some F of X, okay? Each A is F of something. But it's not the maximum. So there is some A, another A, which is larger than this. Okay? Because it's not the maximum. This is some F of X, but this is not the maximum. So there's some F of Y, which is larger than this A. So this A is contained in minus infinity, the next one. So we get everything. There's always, these are the values, okay? There's always some value which is larger. So this means this is an open covering of A in Y, okay? A is compact. So finitely many suffice. But finitely many, we have the maximum, okay? This means A is contained in minus infinity, A0, some A0, A0, A0 in A. That's a very strange contradiction, no? This is A0, no? This is an A, but A0 is not here. It cannot be equal to one of these, okay? Because we are missing A0 here. So contradiction. So this is a trivial proof. One minute, so I give the proof that the exercise, okay? That's one of the exercises I want that you know how to do that. It's very easy. So exercise. If X is metric, metrizable, and has a countable dense subset D, then X has a countable basis. X is first countable. No, that's the same. No, no, second. Second countable. That was an exercise, right? And I now I make it 1 minute. So so the proof is the following. So proof. So the countable base is B. it's BD, so we have the metric. D, oh, that's, the metric is D. One second. So countable dense subset, D I don't like, because this D and this D, no.
We can just ignore this D, the name of the metric.
Why? BD, why? No, we need, we cannot ignore, because we have triangular inequality later, so we have to write the metric. Then it's not nice to have D of D, you know, so we better change names. Y, 1 over n, y in y, n in n. This is countable. This is countable. And this is countable, okay? So it's countable, countable. B is countable. And the claim is that B is a basis for X, okay? So that's what we have to prove. It's certainly countable. The important thing is B is a basis for X. That we have to prove, okay? So I make my picture, the usual picture. What we do, we have some open set, okay, U open. And we have a point, X, I don't have, no, X in U, right? And so we have to find a basis element which contains the point and is contained in this open set. Then it's a basis. Then we use a lemma and says it's a basis. We don't have to prove the conditions here of the basis. We just apply the lemma, okay? If we have this situation that we now find something here which contains this and is contained here, then it's a basis and generates a topology. So the lemma says everything we want, okay? We don't have to prove that. Anyway, we have a metric space, okay? So what I get here is let some ball, okay? There is n in n such that BD x 1 over n epsilon, some epsilon, now make it smaller, 1 over n is contained in U. So here the radius is 1 over n. N is fixed now, okay? M. Here I used n as a variable, so there's m in m such that this, okay? Better change name. That's a metric topology, no? Given a point in an open set, we find an open ball of some radius epsilon, which contains the point, the center we can assume, and contained here, and then we can make 1 over m, this epsilon also, okay? No. Yeah, yes. So there's a point here. But I need another step. Not immediately. So I go to half the radius now, okay? So I consider, so let, I have 1 over m, okay? This is m, 1 over m. I go to 1 over 2 m, okay? So let y be in b, d, x, and I go to half the radius, 1 over 2 m. So now we find it, it's dense, no, as you say. Okay, it's dense, so in each open set we find something, okay? Right? Since it's dense. So there's some y here. This is x, and here's now y. And this is in y, okay? Then the first point is that the distance between these two, so x clearly is in BD y 1 over 2m. The distance between x and y is smaller than 1 over 2m, okay? By choice, no? That's clear. And the second one is the ball D y 1 over 2m is contained in BDX 1 over m. And so it's in U. Okay? And this is the element of our basis B. So this is an element of B, right? So why is this? So now I have, I make my picture, okay? Triangular inequality. Now I have to write the metric anyway, D. So I take the ball, so this is 1 over 2m, so now I have this one, okay? This is the ball around y, okay? And then take an arbitrary point here in this ball, in this one, z. And then what you see, the distance between z and y is smaller than 1 over 2m. The distance between y and x is smaller than 1 over 2m. So the distance between z and x is smaller than 1 over 2m plus 1 over 2m, so it's smaller than 1 over m. And that means this z is in this ball. Okay? Should I write? So if you write, then you write in this way. So let z be in ball dy. Of course, you have to write, okay? At this point, you cannot say it's well, it's almost trivial, but if it's an exercise, you have to write, right? You cannot say it's clear. Then I say I don't believe that you. So then the distance of z and x is smaller equal, so you have to write this, okay, more or less. The distance of z and y plus the distance of y and x, which is smaller than 1 over 2m plus 1 over 2m, which is equal to 1 over m. And this then implies that z is in BDX 1 over m. And that's it. So it's very convenient to start with 1 over m, then go half the radius, 1 over 2m, and then you find the point y, and then it works, okay? So it's short. Of course, the corollary is, that was the exercise. Now, why is this interesting? So corollary, sorry. Corollary, that you have RL is not metrizable. Interesting, but first countable, okay? It is first countable, so that cannot be used, no, but first countable. So this is one of these examples which is first countable but not metrizable. RL is not metrizable. Proof. Q is dense in RL. Well, it's dense in R, so it's dense in RL, okay? Q is dense in RL, and RL does not have a countable basis. That you have to know also. Does not have, is not first, is not what? Is not second countable. That's sufficient then, okay? It's, we have something dense that is not second countable. If it would be metrizable, it would be second countable, no? That's exactly the exercise. So that's a proof that RL is not second contour, yes. And we will do the same next week for the ordered square. The ordered square is also first countable, it's not metrizable. But the proof is different, okay? It's different. And then we have still the third example, which is this proof is still different. These are interesting because you have to work in each example, okay? It's never completely trivial. The last example is even more strange than the ordered square in some sense. No, not really. Well, we will see. Anyway, it's finished. Sorry. 10 minutes.